And anything you guess, it, every time it gets a disturbance, it goes, ah, it shudders. Just as the back of your retina, when you see any image, the back of your retina has a shudder. And that shudder is passed on to the inner brain, where it is then analyzed as a chair or a table or the external world. And here you see the thing is, we are simply saying there is a, if you like, this interface with we, ourselves, our essential self, and the external world or the world. And that interface is the mind. It's a very sensitive membrane that, kind of shudders. And that gives us the impression of the world. The unique feature is that the mind that I possess is not the same, not different from the mind that you possess. This is unusual, because what's the link? You are sitting, I'm here, I don't have any link, some membrane going from my brain to your brain. What am I? See, metaphysical, not physical. We say mind is something that is, in a way, we individualize the mind, but we are sharing the mind. That is why we see the same table. We say, yes, table, except I'm seeing from the left, right, you are seeing it from the left. You individualized it. But we still agree. And the reason why we have this agreement, this again is a puzzle for Western thinkers. Isn't it strange that suppose you've got this mechanism that we can agree with the whole world? This is table, chair, moon, sun. We seem to be in agreement. It's not only that we've got the same physical structure, our inner structure is also same. So this is the idea of the metaphysical mind. This is our interface. Now that this, let me show you the power and the importance of this thinking. Because this is, if you like, an essential part we require for us to really perceive the universe. It is highly versatile, very fluid. Mind is extremely fluid and very versatile. There is one aspect of the mind that has been specialized for a particular purpose, and that is to classify things. It comes with the territory. With the mind comes its determining faculty. It means it starts putting things in boxes. We do it unconsciously, all of us. And this is called the buddhi, the intellect. It is the intellect. As soon as the mind kind of shudders, the shudder is immediately put into boxes and classified and sub-classified, and the classification classified. Done fast, instantaneously, all of us possess this. And that is called the buddhi, the intellect, the determining faculty. If we could not do that, we could not really perceive the world. We need these kind of boxing things. We see red color, green color. You see, they are all different boxes, if you like. So we are already classifying the world into different categories. And that faculty that we are using, it is nothing but the determining faculty of the mind itself. So it's like a specialized function of the mind. So mana and a buddhi, they go together. I'm just going the Indian metaphysics. It may sound a little bit far-fetched. It may sound a little bit heavy. But you asked for it, so I'm saying I'll give it to you. I didn't want to talk about it, but you wanted it, so I'm telling you. But then see the power of this thinking. Suppose you agree. Suppose you don't agree. You don't have to agree. You can be a Western thinker and say, look, I don't agree. It's just by fortunate that the way my this brain processes are taking place are similar to your brain processes. That's why we agree there's a chair. Not that we share a mind. See, the Western thinker. He would not agree. He said, oh, this is metaphysics. I don't like it. Just because you're made from the same atoms and he's made from the same atoms, when his atoms are vibrating and mine are vibrating, we are seeing the similar picture. So there's no metaphysical dimension. It's purely a physical dimension. See, this is the way Western neuroscientists will try to continue to hang on to matter and explain everything in terms of matter without reference to metaphysics. This is standard dialogue. It's good dialogue. And I love to do that. But, yes.
May I ask you?
Yes, yes, please. Yes.
So you mentioned the chair, that's quite...
You can turn it around.
Okay, thanks. Okay, you mentioned about a chair, that's quite a known thing, chair. So sometimes you look at a cloud formation, you say, what is this? Then people say it's an elephant, some people say it's a baby. So, you know, it's how you train your mind, you know, chair, everybody knows that's a chair. So how do you react to that?
Okay. You see, you should stop and interrupt me. Whenever things like this don't make sense, you must interrupt me. And I'm fully, you know, accept, and I accept this as a good idea. Okay. You see, the thing is this. This is a major issue for more philosophy. It says, how can we know that we are all talking about the same thing? How can we be sure about a objective reality? Suppose the whole world that I see is nothing but a dream that I've created myself, and there's no reality. How can we somehow feel there is a real objective reality out there? How can we be sure? This is a question posed by Western thinkers in the last 100 years. And the answer came from Russell, one of the major Western thinkers, philosopher, who said, the reason why This is not just make believe, not a dream world, but real world, is because we have an agreement between many observers about the same reality. So, okay, you can say that the shape of the cloud reminds me of an elephant. Another one says, no, it looks like a monkey to me. And then they'll still both think it's a cloud and we are interpreting in this way. And they'll still come to an agreement. But when it comes to a rock or a chair, they say, well, it's a rock. We can hit our head with it. It's still a rock. So we both agree it's a rock. So there is, if you like, the whole basis of Western thinking that there is an objective reality is founded on this idea that the experience I have of the world is shared by all of us. Unless there's one lunatic guy who says, no, he sings, you know, dancing girls or something. But this is, if you like, the foundation of Western thinking about an objective reality. That's the only way, because we agree. Suppose we all had different ideas. Suppose I saw a chair and she saw something else. Then there'll be a real disjointedness. We can't communicate with each other as well. Anyway, let me progress further. Because the mind and buddhi thing is a very serious thing, a very important thing. Now you see, I'm drawing from the Taittiriya Upanishad, which is in a way one of the beautiful Upanishads of the Hindu tradition, and show you this metaphysics in play. The metaphysics, this is Taittiriya Upanishad, again, it's a very ancient thing, because I already tried to analyze a human being. What is he made of? They say externally, the physical part we see, that we are quite, you know, we can touch it, empirical, you know, this called means sense experience, yes, yes, it's real. They say it's called the annamaya kosha, means our external layer. It's made up of, if you like, material thing. That's what it means by annamaya kosha. They say underpinning the annamaya kosha is, if you like, a pranamaya kosha, means something that is kind of more vibrant and dynamic than matter, which seems to hold this matter together. Underpinning the pranamaya kosha, they say, is the manomaya kosha. Mano means the mind, if you like, this inner layer that we possess called the mind. And underpinning the manomaya kosh, or if you like the determining fact, is the vijnanamaya kosh, or if you like the buddhi. So we have always analyzed the body, the mind, the intellect as separate layers to our being. And we always analyze it. Now, the idea of the body, the idea of the mind and the intellect, we have no difficulty with Western thinkers. They also agree that the way we grasp this universe is the sensory experience we have, we try and categorize and classify into various boxes, and that is how we come to terms with reality.
Yeah.
That is part of it. Otherwise, you can't come to terms with reality at all. You must put them into boxes and see how the boxes sit with each other. And this seems to be inherent in all of us. Now, you see, this is standard stuff, and this is something that comes out of Hindu tradition and in a way agrees with the Western thinkers. Because the Western thinkers have now also realized the very important aspect that we possess, the buddhi. And the way they do it is this. They say, isn't it strange, says modern Western thinkers, and say Paul Dirac, a very important physicist of recent times, isn't it strange that we seem to possess a special, you know, innate, something that's innermost in us, innate quality, which we call mathematics, which allow us to give such a perfect description of reality. What is it? What is this mathematics? Where does it spring from? It is our innate nature. It seems to come out naturally from all of us. And yet, it is so powerful and so versatile, it allows us to give perfect description of reality. The power of the versatility of mathematics is so dramatic. The most minutest thing that you can imagine, you know, the elementary particles interacting, you know, all this solar system operating, the mathematical capacity we possess is enough to give us perfect description of how this thing is unfolding. So what is this inner structure that we possess that allow us to have such perfect description of reality? So they are very simple. They say we call it mathematics. You call it metaphysics, we call it mathematics. We are not going to fight over words. So here we meet up. Now, this is, if you like, analyzing this idea of body, mind, and intellect. So we have these three layers to ourselves, and we are not that far from the Western thinkers, except they still don't like metaphysics. They still like everything to be reduced to physics, or physical, and the activity of physical things, processes and physical things, but nothing more. But we say, no, the processes are in a way already being reflected through this idea of mathematics, which is a metaphysical reality, not physical. You can't reduce mathematics to physical thing. It's a metaphysical entity, and they agreed there. So we meet up with mathematics, thankfully. So far, so good. Now the second issue arises. What is this vasana? Where does it come from? Is it good or bad? And why should we fight it? Surely we should go along with it then. If he's natural, then why should he, you know, fight against something that's already natural? Now here comes very interesting ideas. You see, the Hindus agree with evolution, and this young lady mentioned that.